Hello, so yesterday we paused at this slide and we will start today from this slide. This is from chapter 24. Energy intake equals energy output. So energy intake. What happens when we eat the food? Food is broken down and we get energy. That is energy intake. What is energy output? Energy output is some energy is lost as heat. Some energy is used to work, like we are walking, talking, heart is pumping the blood. Some energy is utilized for that. And some extra energy is actually stored as glycogen. So if the energy input and output are same, we will maintain the weight. If we will have more energy input, like we are eating too much food, we are consuming too much energy, we will gain the weight. Body mass index actually is a formula that is used to determine person's weight in relation to the height. So this is the formula base body mass index is calculated. Weight in pounds multiplied 705 divided by height in inches. A person is considered overweight if body mass index is about 25 to 30 above normal. And the person is considered obese if BMI is greater than 30. So why we should avoid being overweight and why we should avoid being obese? Because when we get obese, we have a higher risk of heart attack, of type 2 diabetes, like that. Our body puts more pressure on our joints, so we are more susceptible to get the joint pain. More adults and children nowadays are overweight than 20 years ago, so we should focus on exercise and on our diet. Now, how our body regulates our food intake? Neural signals from digestive tract. So there is a connection between our digestive system and the brain, actually. So if we consume the diet which has high amount of protein, then we will feel hungry less. Why? Because afferent vagal signal, vagal nerve actually, it delays the signal of feeling hungry to the brain. So if we eat protein diet, it will regulate our hunger. Another thing, distension sends signal along vagus nerve that suppress the hunger scent. So like when we have food in the stomach, when we have protein in the stomach feels, wall feels stretching, and that stretching send the signal through the vagus nerve and it suppresses hunger center. Nutrient signals related to energy stores. You have felt, sometimes we feel too much hungry, and sometimes even we have not eaten for 5 hours, we don't feel hungry. It is like automatic control. How it happens? It happens because suppose we have higher level of glucose in our blood, it will suppress hunger. If we have higher level of amino acids in our blood or higher level of fatty acids in our blood, all these three will suppress our hunger. So if you are not feeling hungry like some days, it is because of higher level of glucose, high amino acid and fatty acids in the blood. Long-term regulation of food intake. Leptin. Leptin is the hormone which is released by our adipose cells. So they have done the research, for example, on the mouse. The adipose cells were not producing leptin. So mouse was eating more and more and he got very fatty. So all the over-the-counter diet pills you see in Walgreens or pharmacy, they have contained leptin because leptin suppresses hunger. Obese people have high leptin. The problem is they become resistant to leptin. Metabolic rate. Total heat produced by chemical reactions and mechanical work of body. So metabolic rate is like the total heat produced by chemical reactions and how much mechanical work we are doing. So that can be measured directly by calorimeter, and calorimeter measures the heat. And that heat actually liberated into a water chamber. So they connect it to the water chamber and the temperature of the water goes up. That is the way they measure it. Indirectly, they measure it through the respirometer because they measure oxygen consumption and it is directly proportional to heat production. If we consume more oxygen, we release more heat. You have noticed when you are jogging, you are consuming more oxygen and you start sweating because your body is producing more heat. Basal metabolic rate. Basal metabolic rate is measured in post-absorptive stage. For example, 12-hour fasting. It's a good idea to measure it in the morning when we are sleeping. So we are not eating. And we should have like 12 hours, like the difference. Now, reclining position, the position should be reclining, relaxed, we should be relaxed mentally and physically, and the room temperature must be around 20 to 25 degrees centigrade. So basal metabolic rate is measured as kilocalories per square meter of the body surface area per hour. Like 70 kilogram adult will have, like, have suppose the metabolic rate, 66 kilocalorie. Basal metabolic rate is influenced by age and gender. As we get older, basal metabolic rate decreases. Males have higher metabolic rate in comparison to females. Why? Because males have more muscles. And females have more adipose tissue. So males have more muscle mass. That's why their basal metabolic rate is higher. Body temperature. Basal metabolic rate increases with body temperature. So for example, when we have fever, our basal metabolic rate increases. Every 1 degree, like, as the temperature increases by 1 degree Fahrenheit, the basal metabolic rate increases by 10%. Basal metabolic rate also increases with stress. People who are under continuous stress, their basal metabolic rate is high. Thyroxine is a hormone which is released by thyroid gland and it increases basal metabolic rate. Our normal body temperature is 98.6 degrees Fahrenheit or 37 degrees centigrade. And we need this body temperature for all our enzymes to work at their maximum capacity. If our body temperature goes to 105, 106 degrees Fahrenheit, that temperature will denature the proteins and depress the neurons. And that is the reason. In children under 5, temperature of 106 degrees Fahrenheit can lead to convulsions. So that's why doctor's main concern is to bring the temperature of the body down, even by putting ice. Tissues can tolerate low body temperature better. So four mechanisms of heat transfer. Radiation. Radiation is loss of heat by infrared rays. So we lose most of the heat by radiation. For example, we enter into a room and that room has a heater on. Our body will absorb the heat. For example, there is a cold room. Lot of people enter into that room. The room will get warmer soon. That is radiation. Conduction. Conduction is transfer of heat by direct contact. So conduction, transfer of heat by direct contact. For example, we sit on a chair and the chair is cooled. Heat will be transferred from our body to the chair. Direct contact. We step down into a water bath and it has a warm water. The heat will be transferred from warm water to our body. That is conduction. Convection, transfer of heat to the surrounding air. So that is like, for example, we are walking outside, it is too cold, heat will be transferred from our body to the air. In summer, when it is too warm outside, the heat will be transferred from the air to our body. Evaporation, heat loss due to evaporation of water from our body surface. So water evaporates from our body, like sweating. Insensible heat loss. Insensible means without our awareness, water evaporates from our skin. Some water is lost through our oral mucosa. Some water is lost when we exhale. That is known as insensible heat loss. Sensible heat loss occurs when body temperature rises and sweating increases. For example, on a hot day, we are sweating because of the sweat gland activity. That is sensible heat loss. When sweating is heavy, we lose water, we lose sodium chloride also, and that can cause heat cramps because of the electrolyte and water loss. So we need to drink the fluids. And it will be a good idea to drink some sport drink like Gatorade and all those sport drinks. Frostbite. Extremely serious conditions due to exposure to very cold weather. For example, it is below, like it is very cold temperature. That can cause frostbite. Blood flow to the skin is restricted and the skin cells, they get deprived of oxygen and the nutrients. So skin cells begin to die. That's why we need to wear the gloves when it is too cold outside. Controlled hyperthermia, mostly due to the infection, but it can be due to cancer, allergies, or central nervous system injuries. So what happens? Macrophages release the chemicals known as cytokines, and they are called cytokines called pyrogens. And pyrogens cause the release of prostaglandin, and they prostaglandin from hypothalamus. Hypothalamus is the thermostate in our body, and pyrogens reset the thermostate. That is the reason our body temperature goes up and we get fever. So now we are done with chapter 24. And on April 1st, we have the lecture exam from chapter 23.